10 years.
Good afternoon. Again, I'm Steve Hensley. A flood watch continues through early tomorrow morning, but after that, a much needed break. Meteorologist Evan Hatter has the latest on the flood threat tonight. We already unfortunately have some warnings, right, Evan?
Three of them, as a matter of fact, Steve. Yes, flash flood warnings. One for about another 15 minutes there into parts of Wise County. They've seen a little bit more heavy rainfall since earlier, but they have begun to ease on out of things. The others, one in effect in Lawrence County that runs till 7 o'clock, and then one that takes in part of Logan County, West Virginia, that runs until 7:15. Heavy rain scattered throughout the mountains this afternoon. What we had moving through Jackson is now moving through Prestonsburg. Very heavy rain there in northern Floyd County, very far northern parts of Pike County, further to the south into portions of Harlan County. Very heavy rain just east of downtown. Southern half of Perry County, some heavy rain as well. Same thing into Lee County, Virginia, and some pop-ups near Norton where they don't need more rain. Very heavy rain southern parts of Rowan County. That's about to scoot on into Menifee County there over the next little bit. Powell County into Wolf County. So if you're traveling on the Mountain Parkway, we do have some moderate to heavy rain working in. Very heavy rain now in eastern parts of Elliott County into Lawrence County, so we'll have to watch that. And more rain beginning to work in from the south. Very heavy rain along basically where Rockcastle, Pulaski, and Laurel counties all come together. That's moving up from the south. We're not done with this yet. We've got this front to get through here first before we are all said and done with the potential for rain, and we'll have to watch kind of where those two kind of come together in terms of the potential for heavy rain. Low 70s out there. Rain has cooled us off, and we've got plenty of moisture for this rain to kind of use into the low to mid 70s dew points out there. I've got the latest on when we finally dry out coming up in a few minutes. Steve?
All right. Thank you, Evan. Several schools were damaged during the recent flooding, including Knott County Central High School. Brian Milam was in Knott County today to get an update on that school's recovery efforts and to see when students might be able to return to the classroom.
Here at Knott County Central High School, the work continues, and literally from the ground up. I'm in the Morton Combs Athletic Complex, and this facility was built in the mid-70s. Today, instead of the sound of basketballs being dribbled, you heard saws grinding away at the original hardwood floor. Instead of slam dunks on either side of the court, you saw the carved up pieces of wood being slammed into a container. So many memories in this building, from mountain classics to championship basketball teams to graduations. All of that is difficult to process for Principal Bobby Pollard.
It's devastating to see the destruction in the facility, and think about all the just all the things that have taken place, you know, all the tradition and the history of our school, and to see it like that was really it was mind-blowing.
As for the academic portion at Knott Central, the first floor was flooded, and what you saw with the basketball floor, well, that's being done in classrooms as well with the ceramic tile. Bobby Pollard said instead of starting school the next couple of days, which was the original schedule, it's been pushed back to at least September the 19th. At Knott County Central High School, I'm Brian Milam, WYMT Mountain News.
Thank you, Brian. Perry County's Buckhorn School was another school heavily damaged during the flooding. In a Facebook post, school administrators say an architectural firm will visit on Wednesday or Thursday to evaluate that school's structure. Right now, Perry County is still planning to go back toward the end of the month. We are also hearing that Buckhorn and Robinson Elementary suffered extreme damage as well. They both may be combining under one roof initially this school year at the former A.B. Combs Elementary. That's what we are hearing today. We hope to have more on that a little later on. Well, FEMA officials will host a second town hall meeting this evening at 6 o'clock at Floyd Central High School. Officials held an initial session at noon at the Genewiley State Park Lodge. Of course, a lot of displaced folks are being housed at Genewiley. Now, during that session, topics like the importance of applying for FEMA aid were discussed. Members of the Small Business Administration were also at the town hall. They spoke about the importance of things such as individual loans, home loans, and nonprofits in addition to small businesses. Both FEMA officials and members of the Small Business Administration, or SBA, are expected to be at the 6 p.m. town hall meeting, and we'll have more information tonight at 6. President Biden hosted military families, advocates, and lawmakers at the White House today. After weeks of demonstrations by those families, veterans, and advocates, the Senate passed the Promises to Address Comprehensive Toxics, or PACT Act, which the president signed into law during the gathering. Ahead of the signing, Danielle Robinson spoke and introduced the president. Her husband died of lung cancer after being exposed to the toxins from a burn pit while in the Middle East.
It includes always fighting for the care and benefits you've more than earned and more than deserved. This law is long overdue, but we finally got it done together.
During his remarks, President Biden spoke of his son, Beau. He died of cancer in 2015, which the Biden family believes was also due to toxic exposure from burn pits. He was only 46 years old. Former President Donald Trump pleaded the fifth during his deposition with the New York Attorney General's office today. The probe is part of a long-running civil investigation, which began in 2019 into his company's real estate dealings. CBS's Naomi Ruckham reports from New York.
Former President Trump gave a thumbs up on the way to his deposition at the New York Attorney General's office, where he declined to answer questions under oath. Mr. Trump released a statement about invoking his right against self-incrimination, saying in part, "When your family, your company, and all the people in your orbit have become the targets of an unfounded, politically motivated witch hunt, you have no choice."
In the past, he'd said only guilty people plead the fifth. What he's trying to do is diffuse one of those costs, which is making him look bad, making him look guilty, and making him look like a hypocrite.
The civil investigation, led by Democrat Letitia James, is looking into whether the Trump Organization inflated the values of multiple real estate properties to get favorable loans and tax deductions. The AG's office says it's collected substantial evidence that could support a lawsuit against Mr. Trump or his company. Former President Trump has also been lashing out about a separate federal probe into whether he illegally took classified material from the White House when he left office. In an extraordinary move Monday, the FBI searched the former president's home in Mar-a-Lago, seizing boxes and paper documents, some of which are believed to contain classified information. President Trump's lawyers have suggested, without proof, the FBI may have planted evidence, and Republican allies are calling for transparency.
This raises serious questions again about the Biden administration politicizing and weaponizing law enforcement.
Wednesday, President Biden ignored questions about the FBI's actions.
Are you confident in OJ?
Thank you, sir.
White House officials maintain Mr. Biden had no prior knowledge of the search. Naomi Ruckham, CBS News, New York.
The DOJ and FBI have yet to explain the basis for that search, but it is not believed to be related to the January 6th attack on the Capitol. A federal appeals court also signed off Tuesday on a House Ways and Means Committee request to obtain Trump's tax returns. Coming up on First at 4, gas prices are going down. That's some good news, but what could that mean for the future of the economy?
Plus, while we have heavy rain in the region right now, much nicer conditions on the way as we head toward the weekend. The latest next.
WIMT News app offers alerts on